Next up here on NASA TV, we're going to take some time out to head out to the Marshall Space Flight Center in Huntsville, Alabama, where Lori Meggs is standing by live to tell us about an upcoming anniversary for a highly successful program that led the way for science on the space station. Lori?
It was called Spacelab, and tomorrow marks 30 years since it launched. Spacelab was a module inside the Space Shuttle's payload bay where numerous science experiments were carried out, and it really did pave the way for the way we do science on space station today. We're privileged to have with us the Marshall Space Flight Center's Deputy Director, Teresa Vanhooser, who, among other things that she's done here at this center, you led some of those Spacelab missions. Take us back to those days. What was Spacelab like?
Wow. So Spacelab was a great team effort for a lot of us. It was where all the centers were able to come together to accomplish a single mission, and also the international partners. So Spacelab was one of those things that that you could see from beginning to end, from the inception of the mission to all the way through the operations and through the scientists actually getting their science.
And it really was fast-paced. You know, we've got 6 months now. But back then, it was all packed into maybe a couple of weeks, right?
Right. We had anywhere from 10 days to about 2 weeks, 16 days. And we had every minute planned out for the whole mission. And so we took advantage of every minute for the crew time that we had to actually conduct the science. And we actually worked shift work at that time. So the crews had their red shift and blue shifts just so that we can make sure that we were able to accomplish everything we need to accomplish during the mission.
How were the missions carried out here? I know we're standing next to the room where it all happened. How did we do business then, and how has technology progressed today?
Well, see, in during the Spacelab days, we actually had all the scientists come here during the mission. And so we had a room for them where they actually could look at, could interact with our teams and could collect their science data. And so today, technology has gotten us to a place where they can actually be at their home facilities, and we can ship their science to them. They can even talk to the crew from their facilities. And so it's really come a long way. And so we were able to actually make that transition towards the end of Spacelab, and so we had a good practice ground for it.
And you bring up a good point. It really was our first opportunity to work with international partners. What was that like?
Oh, it was great. Sometimes I would go after I would, during the mission, I would go down to the science operations area, and each of the teams had their own, you know, they were working together and were talking their own language there. And then, you know, of course, they all spoke very good English. So when they interacted with us, it was, they spoke English. But to go and just kind of hear their teams talking and talking about the science they were able to get, it was pretty phenomenal. So for me, it was a great experience to get to work with all the different international teams.
A lot of science accomplished, and it kind of takes us through the progression now. We've gone Skylab, Spacelab, now Space Station, but everything we've learned is going to take us into the future, right?
It has, you know, both from the development of the payloads that we fly on orbit. We learned a lot during Spacelab and what we do and what we don't do, how we do the design, and are able to help the scientists as they start building their hardware now for the International Space Station. We can make sure that it's actually going to work well on orbit, and the things that they need to do so that it's a lot more crew accessible. So if they do have a problem, then the crew can actually help them out and do some refurbishment on orbit and help them fix it. We also have learned a lot about, you know, working with the crew. What kind of training do they need? Can we wait and actually give it to them by video on orbit? Because they, you know, especially with the 6 months, it was easy when it was just the 14 days to train them on that short amount of time. But when you're talking about payloads that go up early or that come up later after they've already been through their training, we had to really be creative in how we then trained them to be able to do what we wanted to do.
And I want to go back to, you said you worked 12-hour shifts, and I know for you, life went on at home, too. Tell us a little bit about what was going on at home while you were managing these missions.
Yeah, so my girls were 4 and 2 for the first Spacelab mission that I was a part of, and I had the night shift. And so I worked the 6 p.m. to 6 a.m., and so my oldest daughter actually got the chicken pox during that time. And so my husband would take care of her at night, of course, but during the daytime, I'd come home and we'd just curl up in the bed together. And of course, the good thing was is that she was content with that because she didn't feel good anyway, and I actually was able to get some sleep before I had to go back on console. So life does go on, and, you know, that's part of the 24/7 operations, and doing that 365 days a year, our operations team here has to be very adaptable, and they have... It takes a great team to pull that off. And so if somebody has some kind of family things that they've got going on, they're able to pull on their cohorts to help them out.
I'm trying to get that Paycom job in there to talk to the astronauts. But
that's probably the coolest job that everybody wants.
Thank you so much, Teresa, for sharing with us today.
Thank you.
Very exciting.